Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Robert, and I'm the co-founder and CTO of StyleSage. We're a startup based in Madrid, and we basically analyze e-commerce and lots of amounts of e-commerce data for fashion. And in this talk, I would like to share with you a little bit on how we use deep learning image recognition to solve some real-world problems in our startup, and also give some tips that we learned on the way on like what to do and what not to do. Just to get a kind of a sense of who's in here, so who of you already had the chance to play with or use some deep learning image recognition? Anyone? A few people here? And who never played with that and is that's a newbie in that field? Okay, most of the people, that's great. It's going to be a new representation, so to speak, so covering some basics here as well. Cool. Before we go into technical details, let me introduce the problem first. So, at StyleSage, at the startup, what we do is basically, in few sentences, summarize this: we crawl lots and lots of e-commerce data. So, at the core of our technology are web scrapers that just download like over 100 million products every single day. And with those products, we also download things like the title, the description, and also the image. And so, from there, we basically analyze those products. We try to understand as much as we can about those. Is it like a long sleeve, short sleeve? Is it a dress or a top? Understand colors, understand all sorts of attributes from that. Oh, I just wait 1 second until this class comes in. Time for a water break. Understand exactly what types of products those are, and then in the final step, and this is basically the product that we sell, we visualize insights from that. And so today, this talk is about the middle part. It's basically once we have downloaded a product, so we know the title, the description, the image, how can we extract maximum information from that? So the technical challenge here is, given an image, for example, this nice blue dress, what attributes does it have? In this case, it's a dress, it's not a skirt, it's not something else. It has knee length, it is a flower print dress, it's sleeveless, so it doesn't have sleeves here. It's a V-neck neckline, and it has like a blue mixed navy color. So all those things we can just tell by that one little image, and we want to know that even when the description of the product on the website doesn't tell us. And the solution to this, as you would have probably guessed from the title, is deep learning image recognition. And so in very, very simple terms, given an image as an input data matrix, there's some black box that we're going to open in a second, just to peek inside that's what's deep learning image recognition. It may sound a little bit more complex than it maybe is. And then from that, we basically get an output vector, which are the probabilities of what type of category that product, for example, is, or what type of sleeve it is, or what type of color it is. So in this case, that might give us a result like, I believe 95% it's a dress, and then all the others are super low confidence. In this talk, we will open this little box in the middle, just a little bit, to kind of look inside and like, understand in basic terms what it is, and then we're going to close it again, and leave it as a black box, and kind of understand more on how to use this black box, rather than understanding on some crazy details inside that. So let's open the box. You ready? That's the only and most technical slide, don't worry. So just as a basic, those deep learning image recognition algorithms can work on a class called neural networks. Probably all of you heard about it, so I will not repeat much about it, but it's essentially an algorithm inspired by how the brain works. And the basic concept is you have an input layer, you have a few what they call hidden layers of nodes that are connected in some way, and then there's an output layer that kind of gives you the probabilities of your classifier. And so that was, let's say, in the last 2 decades, that was the type of algorithm. From there, it evolved into something called convolutional neural networks. And so the convolution, what that means is, it gets an image as an input, versus the neural network could get any input, And it does something like it takes small windows off that image. So it basically scans the image in like sub-images in different sizes. And not all of the nodes are connected. So you have sort of like streams, maybe you can see it here. Not every node is connected with every node. That has lots of advantages in computing. And what it does, it enables us to have more layers and learn more complex type of classifiers. I'm not going into more technical details than that. That will probably be two days in a row just about this. And just to show you where this has evolved, so essentially technology is going to more and more layers. The more layers you have, the more complex kind of functions the system can learn. And just to give you an overview, for example, 2012, that was like revolutionary, an 8-layer network called the AlexNet. By 2014, we had one at Google that you can see here. I think it has 22 layers. Today, there are models that have, I think, 150 plus layers. So this is an extreme hot topic in research today. All right, let's close the box again, and let's see how we can actually use that box. So in order to use this box, there are three steps that we need to do. The first one is kind of decide which model to take. The good news here is we don't need to develop those models. There are thousands of smart PhDs that did that for us and published open source. So all we need to do is kind of just select which one we like most, use that and implement that in a framework that we like most. The second part is, once we have the model, it still hasn't learned anything. So we need to train it. And in order to train it, we need to collect training data and kind of feed it into the system to train that. And then once we did that, we can give it any new image and predict whatever we want. There is always a feedback loop, so the training will get feedback loop to the model, and when we predict new images, we can use that for training as well. Only text slide, I promise.
On the model, the good news is we don't need to implement anything of that. There is a competition every year
where the smartest people in the world try to develop an algorithm that can predict the category of an object given in an image. It's called the ImageNet Large Scale Competition. And when you look at the results in 2012, the AlexNet, the one with the 8 layers, that won this competition, and they had an amazing error rate of only 16%. Now, Google came in 2 years ago, 2014, they managed to get down to 6.6%, and then last year, they won again with another model called Inception, that went down to 3.5%, and Microsoft has a similar one. And actually, by now, the human accuracy on those predictions is better than the humans themselves. You can think of those things like a fire salamander and another type of salamander, and those neural networks are able to distinguish different species of the same type of animal. Pretty impressive. And the really, really good news is all of those are implemented and open source. So basically, it's just up to us to use any of those. At StyleSage, we started with the Google Net. That was in 2014. And then we switched to the Inception model earlier this year, as that was kind of the latest and greatest. So once we have decided on the model, the next step is to decide on the framework that we're going to use to implement that actually in Python. And again, here, lots of open source options. The two main options that I can have out there is one thing called Cafe. It's very, very old, I think, not all, but it has been there for quite a while, developed by Berkeley. And it does implement the GoogleNet and the ResNet, so some of the best algorithms that we saw before are implemented there. A quite new framework is TensorFlow, for all of those who were here this morning, with the amazing talk from Hema. TensorFlow is a framework by Google, just released last year, and implements the Inception model that they have and many, many other options as well. And then there are all others like Porsche, Teano, Keras, many of which you might have heard of already. So at StyleSage, we started off with Cafe last year when there was no TensorFlow yet, and we moved from Cafe to TensorFlow to kind of work with the latest and greatest that's out there. Okay, so now we have the model, we have decided which framework to implement it in. So the next step is train it. And in order to train it, what we need to do is we need to define the classes ourselves. So let's say classes could be a dress, a shirt, and a jeans. I want to distinguish between those three. And for each of those classes, we need to collect training data to feed it into the model. On our end, we're extremely lucky because we have lots and lots of data. We have about 200 million images that we downloaded over the last 2.5 years, annotated with title and description. So for us, that luckily was not a big challenge because we can just search for a dress and it will spit out 5 million dresses, and we can just select the ones that we like. Or even searching for motorbike jackets or some very specific things. Our database is so big that we really don't have any problems with collecting that. But on average, this will be quite a difficult task. If you don't have access to data from crawling, you can always use things like Mechanical Turk or Google searches or Flickr data. That usually gives you also quite good search results. And what's quite important here is garbage in, garbage out. So whenever you train the system on some noisy, wrong data, it will never be able to predict well. So we developed a system internally that even though we use keyword searches, we can still easily filter out this is a good dress and this is a bad dress. And so here, for example, you can see a screenshot of our backend manager, which shows us the results of flower print dress. And you can see, actually, for whatever reason, not all of them are flower print. So if we would have just blindly kind of taken all thousands of images of flower print, that would be a really bad training data that would never perform well. And so with the tool, we can just select the ones quickly that we like and that goes into the training data. On average, we collect about 3,000 to 5,000 images per class. So once we have collected those images, there's actually a really nice way to multiply that training data very easily by kind of synthetically changing those images. And so we can, for example, three of those changes are rotating it a little bit to the left or to the right, zooming in a little bit, and using different crops of the image. And so from every single image that we selected in the previous step, we get 9, in this case, like 27 images that we can use to feed the algorithm. And what this also does is it prevents something called overfitting in machine learning, which is that the algorithm learns too exactly about that specific image rather than abstracting the kind of attribute that it should learn. And by changing those images, we make it a little bit more robust. So when we zoom in, we use different notations, it's a more robust training data set.
Sorry, quick water break.
The next thing is choice of infrastructure. So traditionally, if you look at the underlying calculations of what this black box does, it's essentially just a lot of matrix multiplications. And long story short, GPUs are very efficient in calculating those. And so in order to do image recognition in at least like limited amount of time, the only way to do that is on GPU-based servers, as that's about like 30 to 50 times faster than CPUs. For some testing, CPUs is fine, but as soon as you start training, as soon as you start predicting in production, you will not get around GPU servers. We use the GPU servers on AWS. I think last year Google did not have GPU-based servers, but maybe that changed today. Another trick to kind of speed up training is to only train the last layer. I will get a little more complex, I try to explain.
So, think of this as the whole deep learning system. That's only the one with the 8 layers. Imagine this is the 152 layers. In order to train this, what training does is it basically learns the weights of the connections between those different nodes. And there are some 50 million or 100 millions of weights that need to be trained. And they are trained in some technical field or some like gradient descent kind of algorithm that updates those weights over time, and at some point it converges and it has learned what you wanted to learn. But that learning process is extremely long. So even for the inception one, I think we calculated how long it would take. It would be like a few weeks, if not even a few months, training just to kind of train one attribute. So just to train that it can distinguish dresses from t-shirts, if we train the entire model, that would be weeks. So that's the bad news. The good news is, what actually happens is there are all those layers in here, but there's one pre-final layer, and this is called the bottleneck layer. And that bottleneck layer is special because whatever happens in there
it goes through this bottleneck layer, which are 2,000 values, and from there predicts what the final category is. And so and the other good thing is that bottleneck layer kind of has learned sort of like abstract features of the image. So it can learn certain types of shapes or edges, basically abstract, very abstract concepts of an image. And what you can do is you can use this bottleneck layer and just train the very last prediction set. So using those 2,000 values, just predict the last set on what category or what sleep vector it is. And what's nice about that is that actually the accuracy is still pretty high. It's not as high as you would train everything, but it's still fairly decent, like really, really good. And it only takes 8 hours to train that on one GPU in our case. And the prediction, instead of taking 50 milliseconds in our case, for the whole network to process, the prediction of just this one step is less than a millisecond. I think we run it like 1,500 predictions per second. So that for us enables to basically train lots and lots of attributes in fairly decent time with our limited startup budget, only using one GPU server, and still running like a full production load with many billion images per day. All right, so now it's actually done. We have selected the model, we have selected the framework, we developed some training data, we enhanced the training data, and then we trained the model. So we're up and running, and the next step from there is to improve the system as we go. So once we have the initial training, and we have the initial predictions, what we can do is with all the kind of input of new images, we're predicting them, and we can manually review if those predictions are right or wrong. So we can get, let's say it predicts another like 1 million dresses, and we developed some tools that very efficiently let us review those products. So sorting by confidence, mixing that in with some other data from description or title, for example, we can sort the predictions to show us the ones that we believe are wrong. And with a very quick and manual, but quite quick and efficient process, we're able to filter out the wrong predictions. And what remains is clean data, clean predictions, and that clean data can then go again into another cycle of training. So we have it over time, we have more and more clean data to train, and then over time we improve the accuracy of the model. And by using that last layer kind of trick, we're able to do that with one service though. So that was it from the technical theoretical side. It's the demo time. See if I can spin this up here. So this is our GPU server here. Let's kill this process. So that's a little Flask application that we use internally to check the results of the predictions. And so let's not worry about the first type. We can select the classifier we want to test. So in this case, it could look at different shoe types, or bag types, or dress types. Any preference? No. Let's look shoe types and see if we can predict different types of shoes. So we're starting this up here. Have that on the right. And this one here on the left. And so let's load this up. Here we go. Okay, so this little now is going to be talking about the Flask server here. And what we can do is we can just search for any image and give it in and see what it predicts. Google.com. So by shoe type, what I mean is a shoe is not a shoe. There's like dress shoes, flip-flops, rain boots. We have about 15 types of shoes that we distinguish in the StyleSage category system. And so this thing here now hopefully will tell us what type of shoe it is just based on the image. So let's search for shoes. Go into the images. All right, we have some really nice shoes in here. Any preference? You can choose one that you like. No? Okay, then let's start with an easy one. Let's start with this one. So this one here is, it's, I would say, it's an athletic shoe in our category system. So let's copy this URL here and put it into our little demo. Paste it in here. Classify. You can see it's starting to spin up the neural network here. It took up some setup time and it gave us the results. And so the results are, it predicted that it's athletic shoes. That's the right prediction. And you can see here also the accuracy. So in that case, well, that's a very simple example. It's very clearly an athletic shoe, but it actually does tell us that 99.992% confident that that's an athletic shoe. So that's sort of the, kind of the archetype of athletic shoes, I guess. Let's try something else.
Which one?
Okay. Oh, wait a second. What's going on? No. Yeah, okay, no.
That one?
We'll get to that one in 1 minute. I want to show you a few other examples, and then we'll go try something really different and see what it actually does. It's also really interesting. I don't know. This one? So what would you say is a subcategory? So the thing is, if we don't know what it is, likely the machine will not know. What do you think is this? We can try. Let's see what the system says. Although I wouldn't know what actually what the right result should be, so we cannot really know if the results are good. But let's have a look. So put that in here. Classify. Okay, it says sneakers 95%. Yeah, could be sneakers. I personally wouldn't know which other shoe type it would be. Maybe just to show you, I don't know, something else.
Blue one?
Which one?
The blue one.
Blue ones.
Higher up.
Those ones here?
Yeah.
Okay. Again, I'm not a fashion expert at all, so we work with our business team on the fashion side who tells us, hey, those are the categories and this is how they look like. And we have someone else that's also a fashion expert who compiles all those training data. So actually, let's see what the system believes that this is. Maybe something like clogs or so? Paste it in here. More than clogs. But you can see here, the confidence is fairly low, so it's like 30%, 30%, 30%. So in that case, we would just discard the prediction and say, we don't trust this at all. If it's not above like 95%, we will not use it at all. All right, one other thing I want to show you, and this is kind of this, it's called similar images, but it's not, is right. Here are the predictions, those are probabilities. So those are basically relative scores, and I believe this is that more than this. But sometimes we just have really bad images, and the relative score doesn't tell us anything. So there's also some sort of absolute score, and it's called legit. So based on that bottleneck layer, if you remember, there is a way to calculate kind of an absolute score. And what this shows us is how many standard deviations it's away from the mean. So from the mean, mules, and clogs, it's minus 1.7 standard deviations away. So that already tells us that probably it's not even a mule and clog. It's something completely different. Maybe, let me show you the athletic shoe. That would probably be the positive one. Maybe let's use this one here. And so the same thing will happen when you have this little snake predicting there. So if we use this one here, that's a fun. So now it says athletic shoe, 97% fine. But if we go in here, it's only 0.73 standard deviations away. So it's still actually less than the average athletic shoe, but it's at least in a range where we would trust it. So if within one or two standard deviations, it's fine. Less than 1.7 is probably really bad. And that's kind of it. Did you want to see any other images? Otherwise, I'm also happy to answer any questions if you have. Oh, sorry, I actually forgot one thing. Sorry, one more thing that's, I forgot, and then we get to questions. Let's go back in here. Just quickly introducing the team that's also behind this. It's the StyleSage team. We actually have two offices. The tech team is based in Madrid, and our business team is based in New York. And we are currently looking for some developers. So we're looking for a data scientist, looking for front-end, for back-end developer, for UX designer, for product manager. So if you are interested in working with us, please go to stylesage.co/careers. Or if you know anyone, we're happy to kind of talk with you and see if we can work together. That was it. So, do you have any questions?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, let's speak louder so everyone can hear as well.
First of all, thanks for your presentation. It was really good. And I would like to know, you said that you used some models published by Google.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if they didn't publish the trained model, and if they did, why didn't you use the deep features that they provided instead of training your own deep feature?
Fantastic question. And maybe just to, I don't know if people heard it. So what is your name?
Miguel.
So what Miguel asked was, coming back to here, is why we even trained all of that if Google actually provides this already and we just don't do that. The answer is we actually did. So we did use Google's inception model together with Google's trained weights for this ImageNet classification. So ImageNet is like 1,000 different types of objects, and Google spent weeks and weeks on training their model to do that. And so we actually didn't invest those weeks or months of training, we just used their weights and just trained this bit, which for us is quite fast.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Once you have settled upon a list of categories, what happens if, you said you have 15 types of shoes, what happens if you want to add two more? Because
if you want what?
If you want to add two more categories, do you have to redo the training, or can you build upon what you already have?
Mm-hmm. I just repeat the question in case people in the back didn't hear it. So the question was, let's say we trained this classifier on the shoes, and we have 15 different types of shoes, but tomorrow there's a new type that we want to add because it's super trendy. So what do we do then? And the answer is yes, we do need to rerun the entire kind of loop again, build training data for that new class and retrain it again, and then re-predict again. The good thing is that we already have all the training data for the 15 already, so it's just one extra attribute. But the training time or the training needs to happen again.
Yeah, what I wanted to know is whether you had to touch the training for the other 15 or not.
You have to redo this whole thing. There is nothing like an incremental learning. So you need to kind of retrain on 16 attributes other than 15. And unless you want to do in some like if-then logic, having a classifier with those 15 or those 1, that would be complicated. Maybe there would be a way, but we do it to retrain. Uh-huh.
So have you explored this idea when you reverse the neural network and it gives you like new design patterns, or you see what's happening inside, like Google does with the image recognition?
Mm-hmm.
Have you explored that idea?
Great question. I just repeat for the people in the back. So the question was, have we tried to reverse this type of flow? And given the categories, kind of understand what are some features inside of the images to detect trends? The answer is no. we use that for the business problem that we have. And that type of back thing we haven't tried yet to do. That's like the honest, quick answer. Yeah?
Many clothes at the same time, like a shirt and a trousers and some shoes. What do you do with those images? Do you just throw them away, or you can split them, or the model knows that there are several pieces and have a need to print them?
Mm-hmm. So the question was, what do we do if there's an image that has multiple objects? For example, you see a model that wears a top and a skirt. How does the system know if it should look at the top or at the skirt? Fantastic question. The short answer is, at this point, we only have images from e-commerce, and most of those are actually quite clean. So we are in a nice situation that we don't have real-world pictures, which is a whole different story. We actually do have photos that mostly show only the one product. The second part of that answer is, we train each attribute very category-specific.
So we train shoe types differently. We train the sleeve length of a dress different than the sleeve length of a shirt, for example. And so the system learns kind of the features around the dress. And so even if you have, let's say, a shoe in the same picture, the system kind of learns to analyze the dress and look at a certain part of the dress, so even a shoe in the picture wouldn't really hurt that much. So the algorithm would ignore the shoe and just tell us things about the dress. I think the next step that we haven't gone yet, but we plan to go, is something called localization. So you can basically train the same thing to learn bounding boxes of products. So you can have, I don't know, 1,000 images with 1,000 belts, and it's like in different spots of the image, and you can draw bounding boxes around it and train it on that. And so next time, it doesn't tell you, oh, this is a belt, but it tells you it's a belt in that part of the image. And so once you know that it's in that part of the image, then you can make a crop that's specific to the belt, and then run your algorithm there. That's the next step for us. We haven't started that yet, but it's super, super cool to do that, I think. Last question.
What's your roadmap? Because you're talking about what you're going to be implementing. What's the final purpose of the whole system and the roadmap to get there?
So the question is, what's our roadmap? So I understand that as a roadmap in technical terms from that bit is to develop an algorithm that understands the products from the image in a very similar way as fashion people do. And so you have to understand that our target users that actually use the tool that we developed are not data scientists, and they don't even like data or analytics. Like, those are words that just scare them out of the door. And so our final kind of ultimate goal is deliver insights that are super easy to understand for them and speak the language that they do. And image recognition is one big part of kind of semantically understanding those images. Okay, so thank you very much.